Hi, I'm Andrew Holdsworth. I'm the Vice President of Real World Performance within the Database Development Group here at Oracle. I've been running the Real World Performance Group for nearly 20 years, and we're quite a large team, and really we're focused on improving the performance of Oracle database in the real world, which is very often a complicated subject in itself, because what we're interested in is seeing people using our products better and going orders of magnitude faster. And this is very much our target when my team engages in things, is to make things 10 times faster, 100 times faster, even 1,000 times faster. Now, this is quite an ambitious target, and very often people say, oh, we'd just be happy if it was twice as fast. But in many respects, this is not interesting. If we were wanting to speed up things by 2x, we could just wait 18 months and let Moore's Law do the work for us. And so with that in mind, we're always looking to get ahead of Moore's Law and do better. And really, in terms of real-world performance, it's a case of getting ahead of Moore's Law and being smarter how we're using the database. Now, one of the unfortunate things about the Oracle database is that in the real world, it's not used that well. It, in fact, is not being used optimally at all. And with this in mind, what the Real World Performance Group is actually in the last few years has put a large amount of investment in education techniques to try and get people to get their money's worth out of the database. You spend a lot of money on hardware, you spend a lot of money on software licenses, and in many cases it's very unfortunate the lack of success people have for their investment. And so what we're putting in the focus is to try and teach people how to use the product better. And when people start using the product better, things run faster, they become more available, they become more predictable, almost boring and less exciting. In the IT industry, they say we're all boring and nerds, but in fact, we actually create far too much excitement for ourselves. In fact, we make it way too exciting. And exciting to me means lost weekends, working all night, and that's not my idea of fun. I like to use my weekends for something else. So with that in mind, let's start thinking about real-world performance and the challenges that we see, but without even going into technical specifics. Now, one of the first things we really notice is in many cases the product is used incorrectly. Okay, this may be a legacy of not upgrading how you use the product through the versions. So the product is configured like it was done in version 6 or version 7, but now you're running version 11 and you're carrying a legacy of those old parameters, settings, techniques, ideas through to working with version 11 and eventually 12. Now let's think about what happened between version 6 and 7 and 11 and 12. Look at what happened to the CPU speeds, the scalability of multiple CPU, multiple core machines. Let's look at the size of the memory and the size of the I/O systems. Everything got bigger by orders of magnitude. Now in any engineering discipline, when things get bigger by orders of magnitude, something has to change and something has to evolve. And that thing that usually needs to evolve is the application code and logic and the algorithms. We've also been dealing with the fact that data sets are being increasing by, in fact, orders of magnitude greater than Moore's Law. And so this brings me and segments me into the next challenge that we really see in real-world performance. In many cases, there is code and logic and techniques being applied to an information problem that akin to what we would call a small data problem for dealing with 100 rows or 10 rows or a handful of rows. And they're trying to apply those techniques and those algorithms to something that might have a million rows or a billion rows or sometimes even a trillion rows. Now, you can see very quickly that this is a big problem in itself. Just imagine if you had a small transaction that took a millisecond. Okay, if you had to do 1,000 of those in a sec, it would take 1 second. If we start expanding that and say, okay, we're going from 1,000 to 1,000,000, you can see that would take 1,000 seconds, nearly 20 minutes. If we would take that to the next level and take it even further along and take it up to a trillion rows, the time to take and do a trillion transactions, each executing within a millisecond, which may sound fantastic to the developer, would be 32 years. So with that in mind, we've got to work at it. Understanding that we have to adapt our algorithms and techniques as the data sets increase and the types of hardware and the performance of the hardware and the software algorithms associated with this. And this is really what real-world performance has become. Learning to recognize, are we using the wrong product, the wrong techniques, and the wrong algorithms, be it either inside the database or inside the application logic? Because this is where the order of magnitude gains come along. The other problem we've also faced within database performance is that if you have noticed, and I'm sure we've all looked at LinkedIn once in a while, anybody who claims to be an Oracle expert has tagged performance as their expertise. However, so there's millions of Oracle experts, so there's millions of performance experts. But this isn't really true. The real reality is that somebody once in their career has fiddled with something and made things go faster. Did they understand why it went faster? Probably not. But they fiddled with it, they took the credit for it, had success with it, and so suddenly they became a newly minted performance expert without really quite understanding the problem. So with this in mind, we also see that people's tuning techniques consist of just literally trying and fiddling and playing with parameters and settings and hoping things will get better. Okay? In many cases, people are jumping into the solution space without really understanding the problem. This is called hacking in our industry. You know, we just fiddle and fiddle and hope and things get better without really understanding the problem. Now, one of the things we really teach with my engineers, if they can't articulate the problem, they better not propose a solution. They better go back, work all night or whatever it takes until they understand what the problem is. Because usually when you can articulate the problem, the solution is easy. And so one of the challenges for all real-world performance engineers is figuring out what the problem is. If you can't figure out what the problem is, you better not make a suggestion. And this gets to something else that we also see, is that people sound very eloquent in meetings and sound like they understand what's going on and making lots of intelligent-sounding suggestions, but we should not be jumping into solution space until we understand the problem. One of my other engineers also calls this activity something else. This was confusing activity with progress. You know, we can do a lot of busy work pretending to move the needle, but until you really move the needle of performance, an order of magnitude, two orders of magnitude, three orders of magnitude, you actually haven't done real-world performance. And if you can plan and engineer to make things 1,000 times faster because you understand the problem, you become a very valuable, useful real-world performance engineer.